the great American West, a land of towering mountains and endless deserts, of mighty rivers and silent streams, a land so vast that 100 years of civilization have left only isolated dots and scratches on its surface. A lonely land, but a land full of life. And above it all soars the golden eagle, the majestic bird which for centuries has captured the imagination of man, has become his symbol for courage, strength, grace, and beauty. He hunts only to live or to feed his young, but he is perfectly equipped with eyesight 8 times sharper than man's, awesome leg muscles, and 4-inch talons which can make even a coyote back away from battle. Where the land is flat and without trees, the eagles and other birds have found the power lines to be ideal hunting perches and even nesting sites. Falcons, hawks, even songbirds hunt from or make their homes here on the poles and wires. And soon, this young eagle will be joining them in the endless search for food. But the lines have proven to be a mixed blessing. The sitting and nesting birds provide easy targets, and thousands have been shot and killed by callous hunters. However, several years ago, autopsies by biologists showed that some of the birds found beneath the poles had not been shot, but had died from electrocution. Obviously, the power lines were at fault, and the electric utilities of the West realized they had a problem. Utilities biologist Al Ansel was one of the first to work on it.
When we first got interested in the problem, we were concerned about 2 things. One was the growing environmental awareness in the entire country. The other was the fact that when an electrocution occurred, it would often result in a line outage and a customer complaint. So we had a twofold approach, twofold problem to solve.
To solve these problems, the utilities turned to Morley Nelson of Boise, Idaho, an internationally recognized authority on the birds of prey, and a dedicated scientist whose research has contributed much to the knowledge of raptors. Here he flies a falcon to the lure. But he is one of the few men in the world who has trained golden eagles. It was Nelson who instigated the first laws in Idaho protecting the birds of prey, and he was also instrumental in the establishment of the Snake River Birds of Prey Natural Area. He has traveled from the Arctic to Arabia, where falconry has been the sport of kings and sheiks for more than 2,000 years. There, he worked on the problem of food supply for the Arabian falcons. But now, he had another problem, and this one was in his own backyard.
One of the things that we've got to do is photograph the lines and possibly the eagles coming into the line to see exactly how we might correct them to eliminate electrocution by touching two wires. Now, the wires on a line like this are obviously so close that a big eagle can touch two wires at once. In some way, we've got to figure out either pull the lines up or insulate one of the lines or make some correction there that's going to prevent birds from being hurt. And on the transmission lines, which are above 69,000 volts, the conductors are so far apart that the eagles can't get hurt.
To begin his experiments, Nelson needed a young eagle, and this is usually done by rappelling over a cliff and taking the bird from the nest, a sometimes risky business. But this time the job was much easier, thanks to a cooperative eagle who had built her nest on a power line, and to an electric utilities crew with a cherry picker. But first, since it is unlawful to take any bird of prey, Nelson had to secure permits from both the state and federal governments and release the eagle to the wild within 2 years. On a diet of raw meat, hand-fed at first, the young bird grows quickly, and in about 3 months is full grown, but far from mature. The white feathers will not disappear until she is four, and she could live for 30 to 50 years. The training can be difficult, even dangerous, and takes infinite patience. Nelson's assistant, David Belke, spent several years handling hawks and falcons before he began working with eagles.
You spend a lot of time with it when you start, and they get confidence in you, and you begin to trust them. And pretty soon it's like the bird doesn't pay much attention to you, and it's just an understanding, a rapport. You can learn to feel their feelings, but not really communicate with them as we think of it. But I think they pick up on your moods and on different people especially. They can pick up on the different temperaments of people and will react that way. A slow, easygoing atmosphere is what they will learn to trust.
It takes many weeks for the bird to become used to the trainer and willing to perch on his heavily gloved hand. And this particular young one has several comments to make about it. The eagle also has to become used to a custom-made hood, which is used principally to keep the bird calm while carrying her in the field or in a car. And now it's time for her first flight, from the ground perch to a tee perch, where a piece of meat has been fastened as a reward. An eagle must be rewarded after each flight, but never punished or spoken to in a harsh manner.
No, come on. Come on. Come on, little girl. Come on. No, come on. Come on, atta girl. Come on.
The first big obstacle has been conquered, and now the flights will get longer and longer until she can fly free.
The perfection that the eagle has to attain in order to survive is just a magnificent thing.
First flight of freedom. Freedom flight of life. first flight of freedom. Freedom flight of life. First flight of freedom. The eagle's flight to
It's a great day for David. The eagle returned. And now she can be trusted to return again and again, and he and Moreland can get on with their work, trying to discover what can be done to prevent the electrocution of the birds on power poles and lines. But before beginning work in the field, Nelson turned to the electric utility lab to find the answer to an important question. Are power lines more dangerous to the birds in the rain and snow when their feathers are soaked? It seemed obvious that they would be, but it developed that the difference was even greater than he expected. In testing dry feathers, he found that the feather would stand 70,000 or more volts before arcing, but the wet feathers were destroyed by about 5,000 volts. That meant that wet or dry, the birds would be safe on many low voltage lines. But it also showed that the power lines were far more dangerous to wet birds. Now it was time to move to the field, and to begin the experiment, workmen constructed a full-scale power line mock-up next to Nelson's home. Nelson, Belky, and the trained eagle were ready to go to work.
These mock-ups are an exact duplicate of the actual lines in the field. So they will be a valid test of what happens to the eagle when she comes in and lands. I think once we have flown the eagles over and over to these various configurations, we'll have a very accurate determination of the problem and how we can solve it. This particular configuration has the problem of the pole ground wire, which is here, being so close that when the eagle lands, she can put one wing on this conductor and touch the other wing to the pole ground wire. Well, for this first flight, Dave, I think that we ought to put the eagle probably 30, 40 yards and back, and you go up there and put the meat on, and we'll just have to give it a try.
Now, should I put it in the center pretty much, or do you want
it
a little
on
the
side? Far side so she can see it. That's the important
thing. A little bit to this side?
Yeah.
Okay. Hey, stand by, Morley. I'm going to get ready to let her go. Okay, camera on. Help!
The young eagle, like all youngsters, was awkward at first and far from the expert flyer she would become in later years. However, a large number of the electrocuted birds found had been young birds, and their lack of skill may have been at least partially responsible for their deaths. Time after time and day after day, the young eagle was flown to the poles, which were of different types, duplicating those which are found in the field. Every flight was photographed in slow motion, so it could be studied carefully. The films showed that had the lines been hot, there were many times when the young bird would have been electrocuted. All she had to do was stretch out those long wings and touch two wires at the same time. The flights went on, and night after night, Morland studied the films looking for the right answers. He began to get some ideas and translated them into sketches, changing this, improving that. He never knew when the eagle might do something different, something to spark a new idea. But Morland was beginning to see some possibilities. He began testing them, improving them, until finally he was certain he had solutions. The first was an elevated perch, because eagles always prefer the highest position. Then came a simple guard on one side, forcing the eagle to use the other side of the crossbar where she could be safe. These and other protective measures worked. Utilities, conservationists, and government officials took the initiative to publish the findings for world use, even though research was incomplete. For instance, how many poles would need modification?
The eagles prefer the poles that have the best outlook and that face the escarpmental updrafts, or the drafts created by a change in elevation or the slope of a hill. So we always find the preferred poles have a good outlook where they can, where the eagles can look out over the area and find their quarry. So there may be one pole with which six or seven eagles will use. And the correction of that pole takes care of a great percentage of the problem.
Actually, he found that almost 95% of the electrocutions could be prevented by installing safeguards on as few as 2% of the poles. Eagles normally nest on a high cliff. The second choice is a big tree. But they also use the power poles. Eagles have adapted to human activity, so Morland thought he might be able to solve the nesting problem with the aid of the electric utilities. Their solution was to construct an artificial nest built mostly of plywood, a nest which could be bolted to wood or steel towers and would not be affected by high winds. But many other things had to be taken into consideration. For instance, the nest had to be mounted on the open side of the tower for easy takeoffs and landings. It took several months of work by Nelson and electric utility engineers to install platforms in several states for field testing. It was no easy task to get the nests into position either. But on this tower, the workmen even supplied the sticks to attract the eagle to the nesting site.
Thinking about is there an advantage over this particular structure as opposed to that?
My first thought was this angle that we put made, as you said, a little bit of a cave effect, but actually it ended up with the lower sunshade and windshade than the other model. It was very difficult to build because of the angles going up. You had to miter all the joints, and it was much more expensive. This one turned out to be great because, as you can see, when I turn this, how that sun moves and goes back. And now when you point that right to the south, it gives the young eagles or the hawks a whole half of the 4-foot square to get out of the sun if they want to stay cool, or to go into the sun if it's a cool year. The artificial nest platform has a better survival rate than those nests on the cliffs that face the south and get so hot where there's no shade, it kills the young birds.
The dowels are built into the floor of the nest so the eagle may weave her sticks between them and anchor the nest securely. The nests are now in use in Washington, Oregon, Idaho, Utah, and Montana, and are being constructed in several other western states. They're being used by ospreys and many other birds besides the golden eagle. However, it is the very first time these proud birds have ever consented to utilizing a man-made eyrie. One reason for that may be because biologists make certain of the existence of a good food supply in the area of the nest. Even the rare and endangered bald eagle, our national emblem, may be using the nests in some areas. The young birds in the nesting platforms have an excellent survival rate. Nelson has climbed mountains and cliffs all over the world, but he had to develop some new techniques for this job where the wind was a rather disturbing factor. The project was to document and measure the electromagnetic field around an eagle's nest. In some areas, farmers have complained that livestock may have been adversely affected when they grazed under the towers. But these, and field measurements of raptors nesting on towers over a 15-year period, indicated no ill effects on either the adult birds or their young. This was true even when the birds nested in the midst of the very highest voltage lines in use in the western states. Although adult eagles are skilled hunters, only about 2 out of 10 young eagles learn to fly and hunt well enough to survive their first year. The electric utility industry, in cooperation with several national conservation groups, is funding a continuing research program headed by biologist Pat Benson.
The relationship between the eagles and the vegetation and the rabbits is very important. Therefore, it's necessary to take a vegetation plot, in this instance, a 100-foot circular plot, which measures shrubs, their height, density, and canopy cover. If there's too much vegetation, eagles can't get to the rabbits. If there's not enough, the rabbit doesn't feel secure and won't use an area. Therefore, there's no reason for the eagle to be there. The whole idea is that the more rabbits you have, the more eagles use you're going to have at the poles. An eagle selects for high-density populations of small mammals or rabbits.
There is still much to do, but it is now certain that responsible people can make it possible for the birds of prey, for the golden eagle, to live in harmony with modern society's needs and works. You've seen the work of 3 highly motivated and dedicated men, Morley Nelson, Pat Benson, and David Belke, men who have lived with and learned to love these great birds. But there are many others, hundreds of people from all walks of life, who have contributed to and continue to work on this program dedicated to preserving the golden eagle, the birds of prey, and all wildlife. Utilities biologist Al Ansel sums it up.
The cooperative effort between conservationists, the power industry, federal and state agencies has developed into a terrifically successful program. This program is undoubtedly going to have international significance to the birds of prey. We've not only solved the electrocution problem on existing distribution lines, we know how to construct lines now to prevent problems. Our nesting platforms are undoubtedly going to extend the range of several species of birds worldwide.
We must have the silver wires to bring us light, warmth, and power. But we also need the golden wings soaring across the sun, bringing us the beauty of poetry in flight and a symbol of freedom in a world that needs reminding of freedom's blessing.
Look up to the eagle, look up there.